Okay, this is going to be a ride to attempt, or film, movie, video, to attempt to show a typical ride on a Honda Helix on some major roads. Sorry if it's the wrong film orientation, I'll try and correct that. Tight bungee cord wrapped around one's chest is not the most comfortable thing, but you know. Now, come to a stop. Leaving a plaza. Okay, hopefully this thing is getting a dash. Can't really see here. There we go. Forward a bit so that the camera can get a good angle through the windshield. We're going down Route 44 from Barkhamsted, Connecticut, down to New Hartford. Beautiful day, about 72, 73 degrees out. Accurate. They're no more than 1 mile an hour over. I checked it via GPS. Ah, with this thing strapped to my chest, I'll bet you that every time I inhale and exhale, changes the angle of the camera. Yes. Three wonderful Harley weekend riders that refuse to wave to me because I'm on a scooter. Not your typical action during the week. Let's see what this person does. Hey, got some waves. Notice how quiet the engine is. Doing 60 right now. Slight downhill. Only giving it about, geez, 1/10 throttle. Ever need to use the brakes, really, except when coming to a complete stop. BMW, followed by a Honda ST1300, nice, stepper bike. So when it will freewheel, on this one with a CVT transmission, it depends on what kind of clutch springs you have in there. I, right now, have, like, the strongest performance clutch springs in there, which means that the clutch doesn't fully engage or disengage until 14 miles an hour. So that's the speed at which, when I slow down to 14, the rotational speed of the clutch will allow the clutch shoes to fall back and let the bike freewheel. So what that means, there was a bike. I think the first one got a giggle out of me. How about that? I'll have to laugh past the a few gas stations for me. Anyhow, with the CVT transmission on here, 14 miles an hour, the way I have it set up now is when it'll start the freewheel. And if you don't give it the gas, you can allow it to freewheel, slow down to 14, and it'll freewheel all the way going down a hill. As long as you don't give it the gas and make the engine speed up to engage the clutch again. I'll try and go ahead of this guy. Nope, not gonna happen. Wow. In it somewhere around 11, 12 miles an hour. Oh, the clutch will disengage, and again, I can coast all the way down. The speedometer on these units maxes out at 81 miles per hour. Again, law enforcement personnel, don't ask me how I knew that. Must have been a scientific test I constructed with a drill and the front wheel drive to the speedometer. No, seriously, it'll do 81 miles an hour if you're cranking down a good hill. And then the speedometer just doesn't go any higher. If you have a GPS, it will, your true speed, of course. That equates to 130 kilometers per hour. I've seen some people out there wondering if their speedometers are broken, if they only go to 130, or if the bike only goes 130. No, it will go faster. I've had the GPS tell me I was doing 85 when the speedometer had stopped at 81 for, you know, quite a few seconds, and I knew that I was continuing to speed up. Okay, nice leisurely cruise, pulling into the home front. Hopefully this will be a nice video. Here. Yeah, the suspension, you'll hear a noise on these when it hits things. The suspension is the weak point of these Helixes. If you live in an area where it's relatively flat, not too many bumps, it's awesome. If you live in an area like I do, where there's lots of hills with bumps and corners and whatnot, it's less awesome. The suspension will bottom out pretty easily on the front, no matter if you've got new stock shocks or not. The front is the leading link suspension with shocks. The back has shocks. Some years are adjustable, some years are not. Mine are not adjustable. So once I had a different Helix, a 93, and I had bought some aftermarket Hagon shocks, and they were pretty darn good. They weren't amazing. They were pretty darn good for the front and the back, but they didn't last long. They seemed to thrash out at, you know, maybe 4,000 or 5,000 miles. They were worse than the original ones. Had them replaced, same thing happened to the second set, and was quite frustrating. There are some Chinese shocks out there, sale for the Chinese CN250s. This is a Honda CN250. I may try them. They're also non-adjustable, but they're only $109 a pair. Versus 200, about that, for the Hagon shocks. So, yeah, when there's some free cash around, I may try the Chinese ones. However, I've only seen one review of them. I don't know whether it's accurate or not. It said that they were great, but they, again, are not adjustable. And a bike like this really should have adjustable ones for the back. Some years do have it, some don't. If you do have it, crank the thing up. It'll give you more cornering clearance. Get used to this thing in the corners. It wallows a bit, so set yourself up for a corner good. Give it gas through the corner, and try not to change the inputs of the gas or give it brakes, you know, unless you have to. Just trail the rear brake. Use good cornering techniques, and it'll treat you well. It'll lean quite a ways over without scraping anything. First thing that'll scrape will be the kickstand or the center stand. So the leaning is not an issue. It's just when it's, you know, pogoing, bouncing, and leaning at the same time, it's not too cool. So that's our Honda Helix ride.
Take this camera off my chest now, and we'll close it out. Hopefully we'll close it out. The button doesn't want to respond to me. Fun of being in the sun. Have to do some editing. Oh, right next there is my BMW R1100 RT for size comparison.